Okay, hello everybody. As I might have mentioned, my name is Tony Cliff. I make a comic called Delilah Dirk and the Turkish Lieutenant. And this is my friend Katie Shanahan.
Hello, I'm Katie Shanahan. I work full-time as a storyboard artist in the animation industry. Most recently on shows like Wildcrats and Barbie's Life in the Dreamhouse, and I work on a comic called Silly Kingdom. And the second one, A New Steed Indeed, just came out, and that's what's up on the board.
Yes, indeed. We know each other through the Flight.
Yes.
Anthologies.
Mm-hmm.
And when I am not wasting my time making comics, didn't say
no.
That. When I am not spending my time making comics, I work in all sorts of aspects in animation. I have been an animator. I've been animation supervisor. I've drawn background layouts. And most recently, I have been storyboarding on TV shows such as Max Steel and My Little Pony.
Nice.
So this is going to be real quick. We have
like 45 minutes in total. So I think maybe
45 minutes in total. Yep.
Yeah, maybe 30 minutes for the presentation, and then if you guys have questions, like keep them in mind, and we'll be happy to answer them. But like, yeah, I think we're trying to condense like 10 years of experience into 40 minutes.
Yeah.
We'll do our very best.
Hope you guys are fast note takers. So, animation principles. This is what we were taught when we started animation. A few very key principles here. As Katie was mentioning to me earlier, in animation, you only have one chance to show the audience what they're going to see.
Mm-hmm.
On a comic page, your audience gets a chance to look up, down, left, right, all over the page, take it in at their own pace. But in animation, you only get one opportunity. So as you were telling me, a lot of these rules come from, a lot of these ideas, a lot of these guidelines, these fundamental ideas come from a desire to make the motion that you see on screen in that split second read as clearly as possible.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. It's just a way to just get it to register on the eye as quick as possible because, yeah, you need to just get it, move on. You don't want to confuse people, so a lot of the principles we're talking about are just, again, clarity, just making stuff, like, really solid. And then it's also, too, like, in animation, you can work through a whole scene. You can work with your timing, but with comics, you really can only show one or a couple key moments, so it's picking those key moments, and we find some of these topics here will help you choose the right moment to put on the page to really sell that idea, that action, that acting.
Yes. If you're trying to come across clearly to your audience, make sure everything reads quickly and cleanly to your readers, these will help you achieve that effect. Obviously, in comics, you have lots of different options, different ways to express yourself, but these will be useful tips and techniques for communicating clearly. With that in mind, we're going to start with the concept of the silhouette.
Mm-hmm.
Here is a drawing I labored over. So we can see this gentleman's silhouette, shoulders, hands, arms, head. We can see his, this makes sense.
Yeah,
you guys can read this.
Thumbs
line
up.
Art. Here is basically the exact same idea, just the pose is a little different. But the outline, the general outline of this character in this very, what do you call it? In basically the same pose,
mm-hmm.
is completely different.
Well, you're pushing it away to just make it read faster. And again, in animation, you would need to do that because it's happening so quick. You know, the second pose just makes it all read much better. First one works still, but if you're going for the speed of clarity, like, yeah, I would say this is definitely more successful. Just keeping things from tangenting, keeping things from overlapping, just little things you want to keep in mind.
Yeah, once you add in value, shading, rendering effects, once you add all of that sort of stuff to your drawing, you can take away from the clarity of that line art, and so setting up your silhouette in a way that makes it as unambiguous as possible will help it read more clearly.
Mm-hmm.
For example, the guy on our left, without seeing that line, without understanding clearly that line art, he could be thumbs up, thumbs down, you don't necessarily know. With the guy on the right, you definitely know he approves.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. There was something I heard on Twitter, I forget who tweeted it, but it was like, with your character designs and some of your acting, if you can't play the who's that Pokemon game and where it's silhouetted and you know what it is, there's maybe a little bit of room for improvement.
Right. Some examples from comics, I think. So here we have something from Batman Black and White. If we look at the panel on the far right, Robin has sliced up Clayface like you would an actual block of clay. And so he's sort of coming apart into multiple pieces. So if you look at the shape of Clayface over on the right there, that's the big blobby guy, for those of you who don't know. He's breaking off into multiple pieces. And I think the silhouette could be more, or could be improved. It would be nice to see the gaps between the pieces that are coming apart. As it is, they overlap. They're rendered. He's added shading so that we can see, you know, he can express the idea that way. But if you were to give us that air gap in between there, that would strengthen his silhouette. Mm-hmm. From the same issue, on the left, you've got some really strong silhouettes with Batman and I think maybe Commissioner Gordon. Anyway, Catwoman on the left there. But on the right, you'll notice that the back of Catwoman's head is colliding, the back of her head and neck is colliding with, I think, the wall safe. Mm-hmm. So putting some space in there would improve that silhouette. Mm-hmm.
So again, I mean, these work well. It's just this was what would maybe make it a bit clearer, just read a little bit clearer.
Right. Mm-hmm. Again, if we look, here's an example from Black Sad.
I love Black Sad.
We all do. But in the bottom middle panel, you'll notice that the ram or goat character is getting lost between in all that shadow detailing. And maybe that is an expressive technique. Mm-hmm. Maybe that is by intention. But that's an example of where the character's silhouette is just disappearing.
Mm-hmm. But that's where we mean we're just talking about clarity. I mean, obviously, that could be exactly what they're going for in the scene there. So, but if you're finding you're drawing something and you're like, oh, why am I losing this character? That's where you'd want to maybe work with that. But I mean, this whole page is about dappled lighting and everything. So I think that's the intent.
Well, it's a challenge.
It. Yeah, it's all watercolor and amazingness.
This, of course, is the extreme example of a very solid silhouette, Mike Mignola's Hellboy.
Mm-hmm.
It's super easy to see exactly what everybody is doing in this. I'm not quite sure what more to say about it, except
yeah, just so there's a lot of strength and power, and you can see, like, just, yeah, even in black and white, or, like, the simple colors, you can see exactly what's happening. You get the speed of it. And,
yes.
Yeah, it works really well, really graphically.
It communicates very clearly. Here's another example from Black Sad, where if we look at the rabbit and the fox on the left-hand panel, their silhouette, their posing, immediately communicates, you know, the rabbit's lowly position, the fox's demanding position. And if we look at Black Sad, he's the cat dude in the middle over on the right panel. His posing and his silhouette with the German Shepherd dude read very clearly, read very nicely. Like the intention there, their friendship, their camaraderie is coming across really nice and crisply. Because they've got that nice silhouette, I think.
Yep. You read it really quickly, and yeah, it's so well drawn.
Have we got more silhouette things? I don't know.
Yeah, silhouette. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you took animation school or studied animation, you would know what this is. This is essentially the basics of starting to figure out how to move. Before you move any characters, before you move anything like that, you're going to work with the bouncing ball. And this, we're going to be going back to this throughout the talk, but this is essentially the, I'm going to, where it starts, squishes down, leaps, bounces. But the first thing in this movement that we're going to talk about is the antic, because before it'll jump, there's that pre-motion before you go into motion, there's that little anticipation.
Yeah. Antic, as you can see in the top left corner there, is short for anticipation, and it is foreshadowing for movement. It is setting your scene up for the movement. It is literally the anticipation before the action. demonstrating it on this little bouncing ball, the most fundamental animated object, that's the antic right there. So it's the squash before he gets his energy all gathered at the bottom there before leaping into the sky. Here it is with a flower sack, the second most fundamental thing
you
anybody
you start with
animates.
The ball and then you move to the flower sack, and you guys would know who were anyone taking animation class. You work with this guy a lot.
Yep. And here it is with a human figure. The antic is the wind back in golf swing. The antic is the wind back in
punch.
A punch, a baseball pitch, a baseball swing of the bat. That is the antic. It is the energy. It is collecting the energy necessary to execute an action. Here's an example from Hellboy. This lovely mermaid lady is about to hammer that nail into Hellboy's forehead, and her wind back with that hammer device is basically her anticipation of the swing of the hammer into Hellboy's head.
Mm-hmm. It makes the next movement so much stronger, just having that really powerful first pose. So this is the stuff you want to think about when you're doing really strong action. Like sometimes if you go right for the punch, it's not as powerful as having a huge wind up.
Again from Hellboy, the panel on the right is Hellboy winding his fist. And a lot of this is going to involve violent action, I guess.
A lot of our examples are punching, yeah.
But then stories are conflict, and conflict
it's
can
punching.
Be...
punching.
Yeah, conflict is punching. So yes, winding his fist back. Here's an example from Delilah Dirk 2. It doesn't all have to be all punching. In this example, they've climbed up a mast.
Scaffold?
What do you call it?
Mast?
Yeah. Up a boat piece, and so have cut loose a rope and are going to swing across the deck. If you look at the top right panel there, her extending into the air is an anticipation for her then swinging down through the air, in which she would create an arc.
Arcs. This is another animation principle, and it's... basically, it's the arc of the movement. When you move, it's, you know, this to this. If you're doing this pose and this pose, it's the in-between.
Yeah, an arc.
A nice arc.
An arc is generally natural result of objects moving through space. Yes, things move on linear paths, but in walking, the feet move through an arc as they go from back to front.
If you throw a ball, it'll go in an arc. Everything will, how it relates to gravity.
Yes, the arc is a very natural movement through space. Obviously, that is the arc of the bouncing ball. That is the arc of the bouncing flower sack. That is the arc of the leaping girl.
She jumps really high.
She does. So, yeah, superpowers. If you look at the bottom left-hand panel there, Delilah Dirk, this is from the Delilah Dirk comic, has kicked a soldier into the air, or sort of vaulted him over her into the air. The arc is sort of implied by the form of her body, by the trailing limbs of the soldier, and then also by the curve of the typography and the whip.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was going to say, too, like I think this is more page composition, but it's really cool how you bring it all around, from that panel around to the rock, to the punching, and then to the still moment. Well done.
Arcs. here you can see, who's the big guy in Asterix?
Obelix.
Thank you. Obviously a very literal example of an arc moving through space as he swings the poor man through ice. Are those Gauls? No, he's a Gaul.
Those are the Romans. They're fighting
Romans,
the Romans.
Thank you.
The Gauls are the good guys.
Yes, obviously the arc illustrated very literally. Even the poor gentleman running off on the right, sweeping his arm through the air in an arc. You'll see it pop up, whether you decide to illustrate it literally, as they've done here, or just to include it, keep it in mind, include it in the subtext, either way.
But beautiful shapes in these. Like if you're looking to get more animated kind of cartoon action that works so well in your comics, like I highly recommend you check out the Asterix comics. They're amazing.
Very fluid. Can't be beat. Follow through. Follow through is...
how do we describe this?
So the antic was our anticipation for an action. Our follow-through is what happens after an action. Our follow-through is the settling. Our follow-through is... the energy dissipating.
Mm-hmm.
In this case, her follow-through is her landing and compressing and then standing back up. In a golf swing, it is when the club doesn't stop moving after it hits the golf ball.
Mm-hmm. Your body stops, but your arm keeps twisting around.
The pitcher's arm doesn't stop moving as soon as the baseball leaves his hand. Mm-hmm. They continue with their momentum through the course of the action. So what do we have to look at in terms of follow through here? I should say,
This seems to kind of flow into secondary action too, which I know we're going to talk about.
We'll get that, yeah.
But yeah, it is the energy catching up afterwards.
Yeah, so we've talked about anticipating the action, and we're going to talk about following through the action. You would be surprised how little action you have to show for an audience to understand the movements that's just happened. A good example is fighting games like Street Fighter. Because the player presses the button, the action has to happen immediately. You want that immediate response. Most of the action you will see in like a fighting game, for example, is follow-through. It's the remainder of the energy being expended after following through an action, basically. here it is with our little sack chum.
Mm-hmm. You see him come down, squish, yeah. Has a little extra bounce of energy, and settles up.
He's very energetic.
Yeah, he's very energetic. But it's like right after you expend all of that, it's just the settle afterwards.
Yeah, it's very easy to describe with body gestures.
Yeah, and the tricky thing is you can show that in animation, but it's like what moments do you show when you're working on a comic? Because you don't necessarily want to draw all four of those poses. I mean, you could if you want to, but it's finding the right moments to really show that mm-hmm. payoff.
So here's Hellboy from earlier. Of course, this is actually a really nice example of one of the things that comics requires. I mentioned that, you know, a reader controls how they consume a comic page. So what the only moment you have to surprise your audience is the page turn. That's how you control. That's the most explicit piece of control you have over this.
Just the time it takes for them to read it. Because there's
the revelation, yeah.
There's tricks you can do too, like lengthening panels or to make time read. But yeah, the only way to actually draw that out is either scrolling to the next page, turn to the next page. So sometimes you want to save that moment for the page turn.
Right. And I think it might have been Mignola who mentioned something like this. He's like, I always want to end a page on a question. Mm-hmm. or something that makes the reader want to turn the page. In this case, I mean, very literally, this is anticipation. I'm sure you guys can guess what the payoff is.
Yeah.
So he's not showing us the face or the fist, you know, hitting the jaw. He's mm-hmm. showing us the fist as it's gone clear through it, and he's shown the reaction of, I guess, the skeleton dude that he... Mm-hmm. I've read this comic, but I don't remember.
He's not having a good time.
Yeah, exactly. He's showing us moments after the literal action has happened.
And it's just this wonderful way of showing this action, because it's the hit happens between the panels. Again, animation, you'd want to show that. I mean, I don't even think you'd show the punch. You'd want it to be so fast. But these two poses clearly show exactly everything you need to see about this, and so strongly.
Well, it's like that with stage fighting. Like, you sell, nobody gets hit in stage fighting.
Oh, no, it's
but
all...
you sell it with the suffering that the actors display afterwards. And so taking it to this extreme example gives it a feeling of greater power, I think, mm-hmm. a greater power than these examples, for example.
Which still work, but it's definitely what we think is...
Katie doesn't want me bad-mouthing these guys.
I don't ever. this totally still works, but it's like if you want to get with, like, I think the stronger, the more powerful punch is the previous example, but... again, sometimes you're working with your page constraints and everything, so you want to definitely get the story across clearly.
This is no disrespect to these artists.
No.
I just believe that these scenes of violence with where every punch lands and sticks to where it is, as opposed to following through, aren't as strong as they could be.
Well, I think it is more of like comedic kind of, especially in the left. Like it's more of a humorous kind of. Beat down.
So you can see, for example, in the panel where Hawkeye is getting hit, that is Hawkeye with wearing the Santa hat, getting hit by the baseball bat. It's solid. It feels like a hit. You can tell, you know what's happening, but it doesn't carry the weight and power of, say, that. Again, if we look far over on the right, that is the extreme end of his follow-through. Swatting that poor gentleman.
And that's all you need. You just need the, like...
Absolutely.
But the level of cartoonish just... Oh, I love it. It's so crazy.
Yep. And you can see the other elements that are coming into play here, the effects, which we'll talk about a little bit in a bit. Mm-hmm. You've got all of these established symbols and shorthand for describing these things. But
well, even like the little cloud down there where the guys just totally soared off into the air.
Yes, yes. But worth pointing out is how completely, what's that? What's the big dude's name?
Oblix.
Oblix has moved through his motion.
I just included this one because I really love Full Metal Alchemist. So I was like, I want to just include it in our talk. But I mean, the page doesn't exactly look like this. There's a couple panels in between, but just showing this really great follow through of the action of removing the cloak, because this is a really important moment in the first comic where the character reveals that he has a metal arm. So it's not a spoiler. It's called Full Metal Alchemist. But it's like that really good antic where he grabs it and then, you know, his action's already stopped, but you can still see the cape flowing around behind him, and you can really just feel the time and just the power of that movement. And I think it, like, even in the anime, it looks exactly like this, but
It's a very good example of antic and follow through. When he's grabbing that cloak and pulling it off, that is your anticipation towards him swinging that cloak full around. It's a very dramatic reveal.
Exactly. And this is where it's good to do a bit of research on things like cloth and hair and how those things move in space to really just sell it and make it look really, powerful.
We have to speed up.
Oh, yeah? Oh, okay. We're going to talk faster. Go.
Let's get through Squash and Stretch pretty quickly because it doesn't apply too directly to comics. But Squash and Stretch is basically the idea is exactly what it says on the tin. It's stretching and squashing of a solid object.
Yeah, I mean, you see it happening to this dude here. He's like, perfect. He squashes down before he leaps, and then everything pulls up as he leaps, and you can see the shapes just being changed. And I mean, this works for this little sack guy, but you can use it in your character drawings obviously as well, and this is a really big animation principle.
Yeah, it applies obviously to blobs and really, really cartoony characters. But the principle also applies to, this is a cartoony example.
This is my favorite. I love Bone so much. But you can see it's like another beautiful comic. Like, if you haven't read Bone, I highly urge you do so. It's a beautiful comic by Jeff Smith. And like in these chase scenes especially, you can see, like in the second panel, the rat creatures are coming after Bone, and then they totally squash into the trees there. You can see them just get all bunched up as they get squished. It's just this beautiful shape just coming, and then...
And then to get out of the trees, they stretching back up.
And like the Bone characters too, just the way they're designed is wonderful, and then the little phone Bone runs away.
Yep. Again, applied to a human-shaped character. You can see him stretched out as he travels through his flight in the top left there, and then his limbs all scrunched up and squashed, you know, not like literally squashed like a blob, but squashing and stretching. Line of action. Line of action is,
like, when you say this, you're thinking, is it the arcs? But it's more like when you think of character gesture. When you do a pose, there's one or two simple lines you can do to describe the pose to make it really read clearly. So I think the examples we have are the best, but it's like, stuff like this, where it's like, there's like one really simple line to show where all the balance is and where the character is, and like, especially when you're doing gesture drawing, this is the stuff you really want to nail down to really sell the pose.
Thinking of a line of action is taking your character and unifying how you illustrate them so that their pose all serves the single goal that the goals that you're setting out for them, so that they don't have a confusing pose.
Mm-hmm. Again, this is about streamlining and clarity. So this is a perfect example, Calvin and Hobbes dancing around. You can see just these really beautiful shapes and you can see like some of the poses, they have the arms coming up, but there's still that single line you can point to that really conveys what this pose is. And that's what you would start with and base everything off of.
You were describing this well the other day, where you were saying, like, if I wanted you to look at the slide up behind me, you wouldn't
check this out.
Make this pose.
Because that's a little confusing.
Right.
But
if I posed like that.
Or like more of a stretching arc. Like, check out this slide. You can see that really nice flow of movement, like that line just coming through.
Everything contributes to the pose that you're trying to achieve. You're not adding in fiddly bits, superfluous details. Mm-hmm. Nothing is distracting from what you're trying to communicate. So mm-hmm. let's see what other examples we have here. So I put this up as kind of an example I didn't like about silhouette, but the way Robin moves through this and the way Clayface moves through this in terms of their line of action are really lovely. Robin's vaulting, I think it's the okay. train of,
what's that? Oh, it's the train.
Robin's vaulting has got all these like really nice, tidy lines. Even his kick looks pretty energetic in the very final panel there.
Yeah, even Clayface has got this beautiful line as he leans backwards too. Yeah,
it all feels very energetic, very 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 clean. I think. Mm-hmm. Again, back to Hellboy. Sorry,
but you don't apologize.
The curve of his torso all flows into the curve of his arm through the punches. Back to this example from Delilah Dirk. In the top panel, the soldier's line of action is a straight line into Delilah, who's crumpling around him. The kick up.
Yeah, I mean, you can just feel it all.
It's all aligned,
yeah,
basically.
Yeah, her pose is exactly like a curve. You can just see that curved line going right through there.
If you look at the crunch panel, it doesn't show. I've shown you that she grabs a rock, but we don't see the rock when it hits him in the face. And I don't think we need to, because the line of action, in that case, mm-hmm. communicates her movement through that space, in addition to some of her secondary action, mm-hmm. Like her hair or her dress, the movement of her dress.
Yeah, everything is selling that pose.
Yes. An example from Silly Kingdom 2.
Yeah, this is my comic.
If we look at sort of the middle two panels, the Woe panel and the Oof panel, there's actually very little in the panel, but we can read that movement. We can read his rising in the whoosh, in the Woe whoosh panel, and even though there's very little detail in the Oof Wham panel, these are technical terms.
Take notes.
The line of the cape, the line of his arm, the angle of his head all contribute to communicating that sort of flopping movement that mm-hmm. It's happening.
Yeah, I think if I didn't have the cape there, it would be a lot harder to show and sell that movement that he's flipping around, or I'd have to find another way to show it. But it's, again, just finding ways to work with your character's extra flowy bits, clothing, hair, whatever works.
Well, if you didn't have the cape, you'd just draw the body.
I'd probably draw the body just moving over.
Curve yeah. through. Which brings us to overlapping and secondary action.
That's cute,
so,
guy.
Overlapping and secondary action applies to, in this case, maybe it's this vest I'm wearing mm-hmm. or whatever.
Or hair.
Yeah, it applies to loose items that are connected to a moving body. So here's a boy wearing a cape. Here's a boy without a cape. He's off the ground, but which direction is he moving? You know, he's composed of body parts. These are all kinetic body parts. They're all attached and moving independently. But if we add a loose body, like a cape, we can see maybe he's moving backwards, maybe he's leaping backwards, maybe he's leaping forwards. That's secondary action, mm-hmm. basically. That's this is the term we have for mm-hmm. it.
Yeah, but it's amazing how just having that extra piece really sells that action. So if you find you're having trouble figuring out what your character is doing in space, things like hair and clothing, and you know, short of doing whoosh lines, will really help sell that.
Yeah, that's the reason Delilah Dirk has long hair. That's the reason she has a flowy dress. Mm-hmm. It's so that I have extra elements in there to sell the movement that she's going through. For example, here, again, we're returning to the scene where they swing from one, well, as revealed, swing from one boat to another. If we look at the majority of the left-hand page, we're seeing the cloaks and the skirts billowing in the wind. May or may not be considered secondary action. But when she starts to leap off, when it starts to trail behind her, I mean, that is definitely secondary action. And if we look at the panel on the right-hand side, bottom left, to the right of overlapping slash secondary action, the way that the soft elements, like the skirt and the cloak, have sort of opened up indicate that, or I think at least help to indicate that they've reached, you know, the apex of this swing. They're not moving forward anymore. They're sort of momentarily in space before tumbling down,
that
realistically tumbling down. yeah, realistically tumbling down the billowing sail before landing on the deck.
Well done.
Let's talk about balance.
Yeah. So you were describing this. We were never taught this, but you have like a shorthand for figuring out how a character is balanced, like a very simple shorthand.
So these are all very rough gestures. But I had a teacher who had an excellent method for determining whether a character felt in balance or out. If you're looking at a drawing you've done of a character and you're like, ah, something feels wrong about that, maybe it looks off balance, maybe it isn't, there's a triangle method you can use. And that is basically, if the lonely point of your triangle, however you want to visualize it, if the lonely point of your triangle is within the two, a vertical line, because gravity works vertically, within a vertical line between the other two points, your character will feel in balance.
Because you can look at the two in the middle and you can just feel it like, you just want it to topple over, because it's on the way.
Yeah, so as long as you've got, this would be a lot easier with a laser pointer, I guess, but look at my wild gesturing. As long as you have that lonely point within those two other points, you should have something that feels balanced. It takes a little bit of practice. I hope through this diagram it feels intuitive, perhaps. Mm. Here's an example from Hawkeye I like, where you can tell that the girl in the middle, she's off balance, but it helps to emphasize the force of her moving forward, pressing the bow into
just
Hawkeye.
Pushing it into him.
From Hawkeye, however, here are some running scenes. If you see both of the running figures, they are perfectly balanced. Their top torso weight is perfectly over the foot that they have on the ground, which I think takes away from the energy of their movement. If they were lean forward more, a little more off balance, you would feel a little bit more of a more energetic running pose.
Get the
pose.
Speed in there.
Yeah. Yeah, tilt that line of action forward.
Mm-hmm. And again, it still works, but like if you were hoping to push your running, like maybe
a
little more off balance really gets that speed.
Knowing how to control whether your characters look off balance or on balance can give you the ability to control that sort of thing.
Yes.
Here's an example from Last Man. Not Why the Last Man, but Last Man.
Last Man, which is wonderful.
The boys pose sort of in one of those middle panels there. You can see that forceful, off-balance, strong line of action movement. And yes, through all of these insane poses, these extreme poses, he looks like he's balanced. In the far right... Far right-hand panel there, the bottom right.
With the kicking?
Yeah. He ought to look like he's sort of off balance. It's a strange pose, but again...
But it works. Like, you see he's trying to kick the guy and he's missing. And, like, again, this is an amazing example of just using, I think, like, the minimal lines you need to get a really clear, powerful drawing done. Like, these comics are amazing, again, if you're looking for examples of that.
Yes.
You can really feel the speed and the power in there, and it's, like, just every line that's there needs to be there.
Yes, and also you can see a lot of excellent secondary action in play. Mm-hmm. For example, in the bottom left panel there, with his, what do you call
the
that?
Cowl,
the thing around his neck and his hair, the way it moves around in that pose, you can tell he's coming to a stop, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Effects, I wanted to include this here just as... A nice little shorthand, a little tip cheat that you can use to make your characters feel like they're attached to their world, like they're not floating in space. Simply adding a little thing that shows, that hints at, we talked about it in terms of Asterix earlier with the cloud of dust on the ground before he gets knocked up into the air. Adding something to little dust motes, anything you can imagine to try and cheat that idea that the character has interacted. Because that's the basic of forensics, is that every time two things interact, it leaves
You want to think of your environment and always find ways to make that character seem really like they're there. And these are things that'll help you really sell that they're actually in space and not just floating on a background, like a blank background set drawing. Yeah.
The obvious example here is him kicking up dust as he leaps backward or forward. The gentleman on the left there, as he skids down the hill, leaving a trail of dust, so we know that heel is carving a path through the dirt. The dust being kicked up by the cart. This sounds like a no-brainer to everybody, but including mm-hmm. that element in there, I think, really pulls together the different things that you've included in your scene. Mm-hmm. Same with Silly Kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just little tiny things you can show, even just little tufts of smoke and just little things. Because this is like really simple. My backgrounds are really very simple, but just trying to find ways to really show that the characters are hitting the ground, they're being shot out of this cave, there's stones and specks flying everywhere. Mm-hmm. You can do it very economically.
And you can use the abstract language that you're using, like a round splat, the sort of starburst type thing.
Mm-hmm. Like the way you draw your sound effects.
Yeah, it doesn't all have to be literal interpretations of atmospheric effects.
Things like this, fire, just figuring out how to, and this stuff again is pretty simple, but just finding ways to, like there's a ton of reference on the internet too. If you need to find reference for different effects, you can find any number of things that'll help you really sell. So here there's like a meteor shooting down, a fireball just exploding a tower, and then flame everywhere, and the wizard's running away.
Yeah, effects are evidence of interactions in your world, and you mm-hmm. want your characters to be interacting with their world in mm-hmm. order for them to feel grounded and to feel like everything feels like one whole contiguous piece.
Mm-hmm. And I include this again because I love Fullmetal Alchemist, but it's just selling it in a way that they, you can see him coming through the fog here in a way that it's just wrapping around him. And like really, you really get the power of stepping through the fog, like stomping on the ground, because you can see just the foot stomp is clearing the fog. And yeah, stuff like that will really help sell your characters in the environment, surrounded by whatever you're throwing at them. And yeah, this comic does it so well.
Yeah. Your characters are not on a stage. I mean, mm-hmm. most likely. Mm-hmm. When you get up from your seats, dust will stir up into the air. So it's keeping in mind the elements that are in your environment and how your characters are going to interact with them. Mm-hmm. I'm finishing off this little bit here with another example from Last Man. You can see in the first panel there, you got strong secondary action on the dude in the top left corner, indicating his forward movement. You've got a great antic from Richard, the guy in the black pants. Mm-hmm. You even have his sort of facial expression in his crouching position down there in the corner, helping to serve as an antic before delivering that punch to the face, mm-hmm. which is squashing.
Yeah, you can see that face just wonderfully getting squished with that big punch. The effects of like a bit of spittle, I mean, maybe that's a tooth there, just really selling that upward movement.
Yeah, very strong lines of action.
And when you're looking at the second page, too, it's, just all the arcing movement and everything. And just, I think this really sells, like, all the principles we've been talking about. And this, I mean, it's pretty much like an animated scene, too, that you're watching here. It's just choosing the right moments to depict that really gets all the power and the ferocity of this fight. Mm-hmm.
If you were Mike Mignola, you might leave that at the bottom right-hand corner of your page turn and then let him turn the page into that. But
just a lingering.
Whatever, let's not be picky. There are also some rules that you might learn in animation school that definitely maybe apply to comics.
Yeah, it's one of those things that, like, just with my animation training and working as a storyboard artist, I'm always like, characters must always be on the right side of the page wherever you set them up. You must always maintain. Like, you'll show it here, the 180 rule, if you go to that next one. Yeah, I guess these,
so here are two characters interacting. The 180 rule is based mm-hmm. on the idea of there being an invisible line between two interacting characters. And the 180 rule is we only set up cameras on this side of that one of that straight line, on these 180 degrees of that imaginary circular plane. Mm-hmm. Not here, here.
And there's a good reason for this, which I think you show in the next because when you're working in animation, you're dealing with whatever's happening in the frame. With a comic, you've got more space. People can look around, so you can
there's plenty of time to calibrate the scene you're, like, what you see when you're taking in the scene.
Yeah, but in animation, again, because it's happening so instantly, if you move characters around, it gets confusing. So here we have an image where it's the dog on the left and the man on the right, and then when we turn the camera around, we want to make sure the characters stay on the right on the same sides of the frame they're on, because if you switch them around, there's that instant second where the viewer will get confused. And this is like a really simple, yeah, as you've done here, you decided to move the camera around. And I mean, that works, but in film, that would be confusing. That would jar you and pull you out of it. In a comic, you could do that. I mean, I always tried to argue away from it, but you have time to kind of get in there, and especially with a page turn, that's kind of like a reset. Mm-hmm. So you can do what you like. I tried to argue for the animation method, but it's like, it doesn't matter. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, it's just the idea of keeping your characters on their own relative sides of the screen, because mm-hmm. on a TV or a movie screen, you're composing for that singular rectangle. Mm-hmm. On a comic page, obviously, that doesn't apply anymore. Mm-hmm. I have a couple of examples of my own up here. So here's an example where I have basically divided the page in half, decided he's on the right-hand side, she's on the left-hand side, and they look towards each other. Even though there aren't a lot of background clues in here for you to be able to parse it or discern it, but like in that middle right-hand panel, if he were taking that pose, he would be looking out the window. But it's more effective to have the two of them faced off against each other, mm-hmm. which would, in film, break the 180-degree rule, but in comics, I find useful to help this composition.
Well, I think, too, it's if you have them, like, kind of facing off against each other, you want them to be combating, whereas if he turned away, it might be like he's ignoring her. Like, mm-hmm. you could use that as well, but if you're trying to get a confrontation, this works really successfully. Mm-hmm.
From Silly Kingdom.
Yeah, and again,
where you've held fast to the 180-degree rule.
Yeah,
basically.
It's just because it's instinctually inside my head where I just don't want to move that camera around. But it's just, again, a clarity. You know, I always keep the main character prints there on the left. Well, except in the first panel, I totally flopped it there. But don't worry about it. but just trying to keep the character acting pretty clear until in that final panel you see the blonde prints on the unicorn take off and fly away to the screen left.
Yes. And this is all related to eye direction. I was taught by a wise individual that if you have... In film, you always try and have two characters looking to where the other character is imagined to be, mm-hmm. Whether they're on screen or not. In comic books, I was taught that you always aim the eye direction where you want the flow of the composition to proceed. Here's an example where I messed it up. On the page on the left, that sort of establishes the relationship of our characters around this dining table. On the page on the right, I've got Dee Dee looking off the left-hand side of the page, and then the other woman sort of looking up into space, and then it's all flopped again when we have to see Salim smirk in the top right panel. So.
And you let this go to publish?
Yeah, that's in print.
New York Times bestseller.
And then this, I think, is also an example of me sort of sticking to the 180-degree rule. He tries to stay on the right-hand side. She tries to stay on the left-hand side. Mm-hmm. I'm going through these quite quickly. And then here's an example of a pair of pages where I have discarded the imagined reality of it, the logistics of where they are and where they would be. If we look at the angry military guy in the center panel left and DD there, maybe if this were a real scenario, their eyes wouldn't be meeting, but it creates a nice effect to mess with that and make it work for the comic page.
Well, that's where the thing is, it's the storytelling element is the most important. So it's like, and yeah, maybe it's not accurate if you were in there with a camera filming it all with the same cameras, but I mean, what you're going for is what's the most important thing to show right now, and then, of course, that's where it's imperative to cheat and just make it work really well. So yeah, again, this was like a really brief overview of a pretty complicated thing that took us like years to study and figure out. But these are some other examples we'd recommend checking out.
We could
out.
Have gone through these examples in 2 hours and it
yeah.
would held up, I think.
Yeah, these are kind of like a lot of the main books they give you, they recommend you read in especially animation school.
Illusion of Life, you can learn from people who invented feature animation.
Mm-hmm.
That's fun.
The Animator Survivor Kit actually saved me because I got my first animation job and didn't know what I was doing and had a quota. And then I was like, save me, Richard Williams. And flipping through, he's got all these great walk cycles. And yeah, everything we've been talking about is so clearly drawn out. And I didn't get fired. So thank you, Richard Williams.
Yep. Framed Ink and The Noble Approach both have excellent, excellent thoughts on composition and color. Framed Ink is not the best written book, but the visual examples are spectacular.
I haven't actually read The Noble Approach.
That's fine.
So I have nothing to say about it. I'm sure it's great.
So I think we're going to close by suggesting that if you are, depending on what stage in a career you are at, comics and animation make for good companions,
I think.
There's
a good overlap.
Yeah.
Like, we both make our careers in animation, and then comics is the passion we do, like, on weekends and on evenings. But I find just working as a storyboard artist and in comics, they really help strengthen each other. So, yeah, that's kind of why we wanted to merge the two and talk about that in this
yep.
panel.
You were educated at Sheridan
mm-hmm.
in Toronto. I was educated at Capilano College up in North Van. Both excellent programs.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, programs are all good. It's all
yeah,
up to you. And
it is, totally.
Applying.
Because even when I think about it, like, the storyboarding was, we didn't get a ton of information on storyboarding. A lot of that does come down to studying and just doing it yourself and drawing. And I mean, that's what you do when you're passionate about something. You study stuff, you watch movies, you read comics, you learn. And another thing I've been telling people too, if you're interested in getting into, you know, how do I get into storyboarding? How do I work that kind of stuff? It's like you make the portfolios, make the scenes you want to draw. You know, if you want to find the work that you're really interested in doing, make the comics you want to draw, make the storyboard portfolio you want to work on. Just do the stuff you're most passionate about, and that'll help you find the work that you are most going to have fun with.
Okay, I think we are at the end of time, which means we...
Yeah, we kind of dragged out. But if you have questions, we are on the floor. Where are you? You're in the...
I'm over near the doors, over in the roundhouse here. You are...
I'm in the gym by the very back wall where the candy machine is outside. Not candy machine. There's that candy stand outside. So I'm right by the exit, table N5. But mm-hmm. yeah, if you have any questions or anything about any of this
stuff...
Yeah,
if you want to call us out on any of our contradictions.
Yeah, if you want to like yell at us about anything, I mean, please
don't
yell.
Feel free. if you're not around at the show anymore, you can find us both online. I'm at Tango Charlie on Twitter.
I'm at Katie Shy on Twitter and everywhere.
All right. We'll see you guys around.
Thank you
Thank
so
you
much
very
for
much.
Coming. Thank you.